All right. Good morning, everybody. Welcome back to TCC Talks Volume 5. We're going to be talking today with Andrew Love and Miss Latanya about how to build and run a sustainable garden. Ideally here to get some produce, some fruits and vegetables that you can grow at home that you can incorporate in multiple meals. Thank you, everybody, for being here today. We're not going to go through and do deep introductions then, everybody, but I'm going to start it off with Miss Latanya here. Miss Latanya is a administrative assistant for the Norfolk Student Center, and she's going to be our host this afternoon. Latanya, thank you for joining us.
Well, thank you, Robert. Thank you, everyone who are on this Zoom session. I thank you, and I greatly appreciate it. First of all, my assistant, Ms. Talisha Smith, is also online, and she will be facilitating this meeting. After I do the introduction of Mr. Love. We have Andre Love from Teens with a Purpose, which is located in downtown Norfolk. He is the Creative Program Director. Welcome to TCC Talks Gardening. Andre, tell us a little about what happens at the Teens with a Purpose and their garden.
All right. First and foremost, good afternoon, people. My name is Andre Love. I'm the Creative Program Manager of Teens with a Purpose. We're a nonprofit youth empowerment organization, and our mission is creatively cultivating the next generation of leaders. We do that in a wide array of like different things. A lot of it being creative. We do music, spoken word poetry, community activism. We do a lot of horticulture and gardening. I'm actually out here in the garden now. I'll walk around so y'all can see stuff in a little bit. I'm trying to soak up the shade, you know what I'm saying? But it's all about giving young people a safe space to explore and figure out what it is that they like, who they are as a person, and just like I say, like, trial and error, like, just trying different things, being exposed to different things, and just, like, figuring out where you fit in this world, all the while empowering youth voice, because it's the next generation. Those are the folks that's going to be taking care of me when I can't take care of myself. So, that's a little bit about the organization.
Okay.
I'll probably be giving, like, little gems and things like that as we go along.
All right. Okay. Thank you for that, Talisha. I'm gonna turn this over to you now for our so we can get into how to start, how to build an herb garden, an outdoor garden, how to plant and vegetables. Take it away.
All right. My first question is, what are some good herbs for indoor projects?
For indoor projects? I always recommend peppermints. One reason why they're good for indoor, just like because they're kind of sensitive when it comes to temperature. So if you have a more controlled area where you can grow your peppermint, that would be really good. Also, like, fun fact about peppermint is it's a good plant that repels like mosquitoes and things like that. So I don't know where, if you stay like close to like still water or you have like mosquitoes around your house, that's a good one, you know, to keep close by.
Yeah.
You know, mosquitoes, the West Nile, let me stop. But what's another good one? I'm actually going to walk up on it right now. Let me turn my camera around. Another good one to grow. Of course, I'm outside, but you can grow this indoors. All right, so what we have right here, this is basil. I wish you could smell it. This is actually like kind of like a lemon basil situation.
Okay.
So it almost smells like lemongrass. But cool thing about the basil, once they get growing, it's a really resilient plant, resilient herb. So like once you get it going and you just like really care for it as far as keeping everything watered and just keeping the bugs off of it, that'll grow back like every year, or it'll just keep going. And the last one I would say that could start indoors, but like if you let it rot, you probably want to put it outdoors just because it grows crazy. Is I'm gonna just put it down here. So this here is rosemary. You know, yeah. I don't know if anybody's like smelled it before or seen anything that looks like this.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Another perennial, just meaning like it'll just keep growing. Like this comes back every year, it, like through the winter and all of that. So those are three herbs that I would highly recommend if you're starting an herb garden indoors. Another one, I guess this one will be like an honorable mention. An honorable mention would be like some oregano. Oregano would that's another plant that that'll come back. It'll come back every year. But the oregano is just a little bit more, I guess you can say like temperamental, or it takes like a little bit closer. You gotta keep a close eye on it. Like as opposed to the rosemary, it's like you give that some water and you know, just say hello every morning and then you good. But but yeah, okay. Those would be some good ones to start with.
Okay. Thank you for that. My next question would be, what supplies do I need to begin? As far as like trying to start planting a plant, what are the supplies? Yes.
Oh, okay. Well, if you want to cut out some of like the building process, because I'll show y'all our beds here in a minute, but you could really just start out with like the little seed, the planters, like the ones that the little plastic, like sometimes they'll come in like sets of four, mm-hmm. or six. Yeah, you can start out with that, with those. Okay. Of course, get you like a couple of like pots or whatever, so when it's time to change them, you can just go ahead and make that happen. But okay. Just that and some soil, like you can start like with some soil from Home Depot, like little Miracle-Gro, something like that. I would recommend that whichever herb that you do decide, just look up if it requires a little bit more acidity or anything like that in the soil to make it work, like to make it grow like just better. But yeah, that's pretty much what you need. And then of course, you know, you need some water, just a space, mm-hmm. A space that like they have, like they all have their own space and a good source of sunlight.
Okay.
But, yeah, that's pretty much what you would need. Unless you wanted to like build your own bed, you know, I'll give y'all an example. Hold on a second. Again, this is outside, so of course it's a huge version, but okay. This bed right here, it was like built with this. It's just metal, and then you got your wood right here to support. But and then of course it goes like right down into the ground. We filled it with soil. We got to use some compost too, just to mix in, so we have like some good, like it has nutrients in the soil. You're gonna want to treat your plants almost. I'm not even gonna say almost. You're gonna want to treat your plants how you treat yourself. So. You know, you want to eat nutritious food. Like you want to get out in the sun. You want to get out in the sun when you can. You know, if it's too hot, of course you're gonna go inside. So when you're starting your garden, think about it as if you're caring for yourself or you're caring for another human being, because it kind of goes hand in hand.
That makes sense. That makes sense. Yes. I never thought of it like that.
Hey, can I piggyback on that one with a quick question? Andre, what do you guys use for your compost? What do you guys put? Do you guys have a bin or a barrel that you put stuff in? And what do you guys put in there?
Yeah, we have We have a compost bin, and then we built one as well. The one, the garden that I'm in right now, we don't have a compost over here, just because you're not supposed to have one in an urban area like that. But you can buy a compost kit, And pretty much it has like a little gate at the bottom so you can like sift the soil to come through. But for us, like, we put any of the fruits, vegetables that may be going bad, like any flowers that are kind of on the way out, anything that'll break down in there. Also, if you want to get your compost like really started and get a jump start, like, you can put like some earthworms in there, or different things that'll break all of those things down, you know. And once you get that going, you're gonna want to sift it around often, just so it doesn't all just sit there. And like, once something breaks down, you can move it, and then it'll keep going into the soil.
And is there a time limit where how long you should let stuff sit and decompose before you use it as compost?
You really would just have to watch it. And that's like, we come back to our compost like every couple of days just to kind of sift it around. And you'll start, like, after a while, I'll say, because it takes a good while like to get like a substantial amount of soil. But after a couple of months of just doing that process, like, you'll start seeing a lot more soil like coming down at the bottom, and then you can start using, and that's great soil to use for your beds, because like it's not really like chemicals in there. It's like the nutrients are going right back into the soil, and then you're gonna be cycling that back into your plants.
Circle of life.
Right.
Wow.
It's crazy. Disney was on to something.
Okay.
All right. Now, my next question would be, is the process different from indoor or outdoor plants? Is it different, or do you still do the same thing?
It is. I would say it's a little bit different just because the indoor is a more controlled environment. So, mm-hmm. say for instance, I have a peppermint plant at home, and because of the temperature in my home, I ended up having to take it outside because it's summertime. So I'm like, we're going to crank this AC up a bit. I'm sorry. Not sorry, y'all. If I'm not alive, I can't keep y'all alive. So, yeah, and I saw that it wasn't doing good because it was kind of at a cooler, like a really like cool temperature. So once I set it outside, it kind of came back to life. You know,
yes.
So, it really goes down into your research. Plants like, let me find some pretty ones. Like plants like here we go. We got like tomatoes and stuff over here. Mm-hmm. Like they tend to do really well outside. Especially at this time of year, they get plenty of natural sunlight. You know, we water them. We water everything daily, of course, because of the size of the bed and it's blazing outside all the time. So for some plants, it's easier for them to grow inside. It all depends on the temperature that they're comfortable at.
I have a question. The peppermint, does it withstand during the winter? Does it die back? Will it come back during the, you know, the fall?
If you leave it,
I'm thinking about.
If you leave it outside, it'll die off. Uh-huh. But like once it gets a little bit colder, I'll bring my plant inside.
Okay. You know? Okay. So your plant is still in a pot, man. You didn't transfer it out the pot.
Gotcha. Yeah, that's how I'm doing mine, and I just keep transferring the pots once it gets bigger.
Okay.
And just a heads up with my experience with mint is it's a super spreader, so it's probably better to hold it in, have it in a container than on the ground, because it'll take over your whole yard.
Yes, it will. It definitely will.
Oh, okay.
Right.
But it keeps the mosquitoes away, though.
Right. It does. About right.
The basil is a good natural mosquito repellent too.
Okay.
Can you blend both of those together? I'm sorry, Talisha.
No problem.
Together, I would recommend doing them in separate pots, just because, like, I couldn't see what my man's saying. Robert said, like, the peppermint is really invasive, so mm-hmm. it'll be like, oh, word, I'm gonna just take all of this, thanks.
Okay,
Dominic. Okay. Yeah. My next question would be, if I don't have sunlight in my kitchen, what should I do?
If you don't have sunlight in your kitchen, mm-hmm. you can definitely invest in getting, like, the indoor UV lights. Like, they have a couple of plant stores out here that you can get a setup like that.
Okay.
And pretty much you would mimic how the sun would do. So yeah, if you know you need more like direct sunlight on a plant for a long time, that'll be the one that you let it you let that sit under that light for longer.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Gotcha. Thank you for that tip. My next one would be house plants as a newbie. What should I start off with?
I think cacti are great starter plants, because they're they don't need a lot of water. That's something that you can sit in your window and kind of let it rot. Palm plants. You'll see the big ones that are in people's houses. Those are really good starter plants as well. I'll say I have one at my house, and I got it. It was probably about three feet tall, and now it's like 6 feet tall now. It's tall as me in its pot. Oh. But yeah, they're not too hard to take care of, and
okay,
like a lot of palm plants, you wouldn't even have to like water them every day, like every couple of days, and then you would just rotate it to make sure that your stem is strong.
Okay,
thank you. And my next one would be, what household plants are good for air purifying, promoting good sleep, digestion, and its low maintenance?
The digestion. You're throwing them at him, Felicia.
What did you say?
I say you're just throwing them at him today.
I've got to get my answers so I can start my stuff, and then I got to get together.
I definitely feel that. I'll say for the digestion, I'd definitely have to revisit and check. I know I put mint and what's the other one? It's gonna come to me at some random time, but I know like in like my drinks, like I put like mint, things like lemon. Those help, like that kind of stuff helps with your with digestion. Mm-hmm. The palm plants, those are really good for your air, like kind of filtering the air in your space, especially bamboo palm plants. If you can get lavender, like in your house, anything that's like aromatic like that, that definitely helps with like relieving stress, helping you sleep. Eucalyptus can help with that as well.
Okay.
Good. Yeah, those are the ones that come off right off the top of my head.
Okay.
Yeah. I would highly recommend the lavender. Like, okay. It smells great, but oh man, you'd be sleeping like a baby. And you can put all those things together and make tea.
Yep. Yeah, definitely. Okay. Thank you for that tip. My next.
Another cool thing about having a garden, you teach yourself how to like grow your own food and be more self-sufficient. And okay. There's like no extra chemicals and stuff on that.
Okay.
Wow. Okay.
So we started in, I want to say 1996. Yeah, we started at the Basilica of St. Mary's. That's good. I'm trying to tell you. We started at the Basilica of St. Mary's out here in downtown Norfolk. My mother, Deirdre Love, actually started the teen. She was the head over the teen ministry. And we kind of just, well, not we. I was like little when this was happening. But she wanted to just do more with with the teens and like really get folks educated. Like we started mainly educating ourselves and others about HIV, AIDS, STD awareness, safe practices, and stuff like that. So that's why we want to educate folks on if you're going to engage in risky behavior or if you even know what is risky, you know. But fast forward, around 2007, did the 501(c) became a nonprofit organization. Been working around the same area ever since, but now we're over at the Vivian C. Mason Center. And before COVID happened, we would do programs five days a week. We have all kinds of different events on weekends, take trips. Oh, sorry, my phone is losing juice. But yeah, also for volunteers, like we partner with TCC, North State, ODU, Hampton, like a lot of the colleges in the area, EVMS. So we have a lot of students come through here. We do in-school programming as well. Work with the city of Norfolk. Just any way we can. Like lots of different opportunities for people to volunteer. And you don't have to be a part of a school to volunteer. If you just want to see something good happen in your community, you can come out.
Okay.
A couple things to remember. You want to dig your hole twice the size of the base of your plant. So if you buy a plant, you know, a tomato plant at the store that's, you know, a certain size, your hole that you dig will be twice as wide and twice as deep. You want to make sure that anything planted new is getting water every day for at least a week before you start to tailor that back. A couple other things, tomato plants tend to get overly full and they'll fall over. So you want to go through, and if you see two branches and there's growth in between, you want to pull that out because that new growth is going to add to it. And the reality is the more plant branches and leaves that you have, the less energy it has towards its fruit. So if you're creating a fruiting or a vegetable-based plant, you got to make sure and trim the unnecessary stuff that's off there. Like Andrew was saying, you can crush all that stuff up and just put it right back in the plant and it'll decompose and give back to it. But that's the big one there with tomatoes especially, is that overgrowth. If you let it get too big without trimming, you're going to lose track and you're going to get less successful produce on it. Try not to put too much stuff in. If you want to really make sure you're paying attention to those labels. If things are too close together, one will overshadow the other and the plants are going to die. So I know we all want to get as much produce as we can, but when you're dealing with a box or when you're dealing with a trough or a single pot, you want to make sure you're spacing stuff out so that each individual plant has the opportunity to reach the sun. Because if it gets, like I said, if it gets overshadowed, we all see the plants grow towards the sun. And if they grow over top of something, that plant's not going to survive.
Right.
And then lastly, a couple of the things that we want to talk about here. I mean, obviously, we're going to see cold winters in Virginia. So a lot of the citrus fruit needs to definitely come inside. You can bring your herb garden inside as well. So for instance, I've got a lemon tree in the backyard right now, and I won't plant it in the ground because it's got to come in. As soon as that frost hits, a lot of those plants will die. So if you want to keep them going year after year, you're going to need to bring them in before the first frost hits. Okay. And you know, like Andre was saying, just put them close to the window so they get that sunlight, and you're going to want to water them. Another thing, one last tidbit here is when you buy a pot, especially the plastic ones, there are little holes in the bottom that you can punch out, and those are for external use. If you're doing indoor plants, you don't want to punch those holes out. Obviously the water is going to run through the bottom. But the other reason is you want to have a solid bottom for your plant, for your pot, so that the water stays in there and continues to absorb. That's why you don't usually need to water every day. Usually once every 3 to 5 days is okay. But those exterior ones, you want to have drainage holes, and you want to make sure you're watering them at least once every other day, if not once a day.
Okay.
And I have one question for everybody. Does everybody have, I don't know if anybody started gardening besides Robert and Miss Lasagna, but I have a plant that is about 25 years old that my grandmother started. She started the plant, and everybody is actually going to get a piece of it that we're all going to pot together. So my question for everybody, does anybody have a plant that's that old? Because it's so beautiful that it's been blossoming for years. So I want to know, does anybody have, you know, anything like that that they kind of cherish? No?
I was going to say I don't, but my granddaughter has a plant that I bought her when she started college, and she's 33 now, and she still has it.
Okay. That is great.
I have a plant.
I have one more question.
Like that. Go ahead.
I have the hospice plants, the one with those big flowers on it. I have them in pots, and I have two of them. One of them I can water once a week. One of them, I don't know what's wrong with that plant. The more I water, it looks like it's just fading away. I don't, anybody have any suggestions?
So if it's got too much water, it'll wilt. Yeah. And if it has not enough water, it will brown and dry out. So you got to make sure you're watching that. If it's looking wilty, it's too much water.
Oh, okay. But the other one is doing fine.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, they all have personalities like people.
Yeah. Okay, I watched the word on that one. Thank you.
Okay. You're welcome. Can I share with you guys?
I would like
to more. So questions. I just want to give you guys, I don't know if you guys can see it. Hold on, I got this.
That's pretty.
Oh, yes. It is nice.
Yeah. What's that, Robert?
These were planted as well. Mm-hmm. So we got all kinds of hot peppers.
That's pretty.
This was from a pre-purchased plant. These are tomatoes. And then if you're looking, like he was talking about oregano, additional peppers, additional tomatoes. You'll see they each have their own trough or pot, and everything is spaced out. So just remember to keep everything spaced, watered, and sun, and you should be good to go.
Okay.
All right.
So, Robert, how did you get all your plants and then show them like that?
Say it again.
Okay, go.
Where'd she go? Did she disappear?
Well, I'm right here. Robert, how did you get all your plants like that?
How did I get them what?
To show them. I have a mango seed plant that I was trying to grow, and she withering now. It's like, and I have it outside, and I was just wondering if I need to bring her inside. And how you show it?
So
I'm new at this thing here.
Yeah. So the big things to remember as well is make sure you're watering after the sun sets, because otherwise it'll amplify the sun. It'll burn those.
Right. That's like that. Right.
It'll burn the leaves on it.
First thing in the morning before it come up.
Right. Exactly.
Because my leaves they're burning.
Yeah. And that's what it is from. It's from the sunlight hitting the water droplets. You also want to make sure those roots are soaked. So soak them either first thing in the morning or at night before you go to bed, just to make sure that they're completely wet. So what I tend to do is make sure water is sitting at the top, and then as it seeps down, I know that it's reaching the roots that are down there. The other thing is, and it's really important, when you're buying plants, just make sure you're looking at how much sun they need. If it's a full sun, put it in the full sun. If it's, you know, 6 to 4 hours, you got to put it somewhere where it gets half shade during the day, half sun, because that stuff really does make a difference.
But I didn't buy that one, Robert. I had me a mango, and I ate it, and I dried the seed out, then I let it grow its own root, and then that's how I started mine.
That's awesome.
Yes.
So.
Yeah, we could do a whole program on that, on how to regrow produce from the grocery store.
Yeah, that's what I did. I did some loose seeds like that, and I put them in some eggshells. I have about 4 of those that's trying to grow now.
Yep. Yeah, you can grow seedlings in eggshells because they decompose. The other one I've seen is if you take toilet paper rolls and you just fold up the bottom, fill it up with dirt, and put the seed in it, and then keep it in your house, keep it in the sun, right, water it. And then once it starts to grow, you can plant it, whether in a pot or in the ground, but that toilet paper will decompose. And that's the real big thing. When you're transplanting plants, you want to put as little damage to those roots as you possibly can.
Okay.
Any more questions? Any more comments?
Nope, handing it back over to you.
Oh, thank you, Ms. Talisha. And thanks everyone for coming to today's Zoom meeting. What I would like you to do, if you decide to plant any plants or do a herb garden or whatever, I have a million plants, post them on our Instagram page or our TCC Facebook page. This meeting right here will be uploaded as well. So I would like to see some of the things you have created on your own and expose the rest of the campus to as well. I appreciate you. Thank you, Dr. Warren. You're in the background. You're not saying much, but I see you. Willette, that's Talisha. Robert, of course, you know, I thank you. Ms. Doris, you as well. Andre, who is not here now, but I thank him. He was awesome. Any more comments before we close this meeting off? And
well, what were you going to say about your plant? I know you were going to mention.
Okay. I have a plant that I'm going to post this plant. When I decided to pot it, it was just one stem. So I put it in a water bottle. And when I put it in the dirt, this plant is huge. And it's laying up against the kitchen wall, like, because it needs some support. So that's the plant that I'm going to post. And I've had that plant, I want to say 6 years. And it started off with one little single stem. I'm going to make sure I post that one.
Good. Okay. All right.
All right, you all. You have a beautiful weekend. Stay dry. Stay safe. Everybody, I know we are practicing social distancing. Everybody have their mask?
Yes, ma'am.
Where your mask at? Where your mask at? I have several of them. So make sure you stay safe. And till next time.
Till next time. Thank you, everybody.